This is Dr. Max Schultz, pastor of the Heritage Baptist Bible Church in Walnut Grove, Minnesota. It is our privilege to be with you now for this half hour, and we hope that you have your Bibles out and you're ready to follow along, because that's the only way that we learn the Word of God is to give it out and you take it in. We'll be back in just a moment. It is so good to be with you again this Sunday morning, as it is each Sunday morning at the same time. And again, we count it our privilege to come into your homes and to spend this time with you. You have a warm welcome here, where you'll be met by a group of warm, friendly Christians that are glad to have you in our service. And maybe you've just moved into the area. You're hunting an independent, fundamental, Bible-believing church. We use the Bible as our textbook, not man's philosophy or wisdom or the things of the secular world. But nevertheless, thus saith the Lord, is what our Bible study is predicated upon, nothing but the Bible. If you have your Bibles now, can we continue on and go over here to the book of James now, if you will? And we're here to the last chapter here, speaking about the faith healers and what God says here. If any among you that are sick, call the elders of the church, let them come and pray. And they are to do that. Anointing with the oil, as we've said before, was a custom of the time, as it was to greet one another with a holy kiss, or as it was to be in public. A woman was to have her face veiled, or she was labeled as a bad woman. And today we find out those customs are not with us today. We greet with a handshake, and the veil, as far as that custom is concerned, is no longer there. We have medicine that replaces the anointing with the oil. And therefore, but we ought to pray, and the effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. And then God goes on down here in verse 17, says that Elijah was a man subject to like patience as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. And God pulls this from the Old Testament, showing how he did honor the prayer of Elijah. And when it's God's will, he will honor your prayer. If it be his will now, we ought to always remember to pray that if it be God's will, I will do this or that. But always willing to accept God's will over ours, and sometimes later we'll find out what the purpose of it is. Again, while we're going down, we want to cover a few things here because of some of the misconceptions concerning healing. We find out, first of all, that in the Old Testament, and I want to put this out, it's a good principle that if you'll mark it down, you can follow right along with it, and you'll find out it is true that God at the time gave the right to heal to the apostles. You'll find out also when you search the New Testament that only those who Christ commissioned himself and who the apostles laid their hands on had the right to heal. When those stopped, in other words, the apostles had the right to do it, they laid their hands on someone, they were commissioned, they had the right to do it, and then it ceased right there. And then we find in the 28th chapter of the book of Acts, as far as we know, is the last recorded miracles, those performed by the Apostle Paul, and then those gifts passed off of the scene as far as men are concerned. And, of course, Christ can heal whenever he sees fit to do it. He can overrule and do that, but God expects us to use the medicine available in order to heal our bodies. Now, when we have the counterfeits today in the faith healers, and we have people flocking there, it seems like a last resort, and trying to get their bodies healed, and yet we find out that the wages of sin is death, and eventually our bodies, no one can heal them, they are definitely going to die. So we take the Bible here, and let's go over here now, if you will, and let's notice here and look at something in John chapter 5. Let's look at this, because many times we are told, well, if you have enough faith, you can be healed. And I would like to show you that there are some times in the New Testament when Christ honored the faith of a person in order to be healed. John chapter 4, we find out the nobleman's son here. And where the nobleman had faith, wasn't his son, didn't depend upon him. And Christ said, you go back. He went back and checked. He stayed all night that night, went back the next day. He had faith, and Christ had healed him the very same hour that he had said that. Now, we're over to John chapter 5, and here's something very interesting here for the faith healers to cope with. You never hear them bring these things out. They always bring out, well, if you have enough faith, you can be healed. Now, that's a lie out of the pits of hell. That is not true, because there are times when it is not God's will that you be healed, or at this particular time, and maybe there is a thorn in your flesh that you're going to carry until you die, and there is a purpose for it. Notice in John chapter 5 now, if you will, you find out here of the healing of the impotent man. Now, this ailment that he had was because of some sin that he had done. We're not told what it was, but he had had this ailment some 38 years. Now, notice here, if you will, in verse 5. And a certain man was there and which had an infirmity some 38 years. Now, we find out here that Christ had healed the man, the impotent man. We come on down now. And notice here in verse 13, and he that was healed was not who it was, for Jesus had not conveyed himself away, the multitude being in that place. Now we find out at the time he was healed, it did not depend upon his faith at all, because he didn't even know who it was that healed him. But then we find out that in verse 14, afterwards Jesus findeth him in the temple, and said unto him, behold, thou art made whole, sin no more, lest a worse thing come unto thee. So whatever ailment he had because of sin. Christ healed him, but the other point is, he did not know who it was. It did not depend upon his faith. Christ used him to show his power to the Jewish people to prove that he was the Messiah. Now, let's go on over here to John chapter 9. Let's take a look at this, if you will, just a second, and we find the same thing over here. In John chapter 9 here, we find out here with a blind man, and they ask the same question as what is proposed by those of the faith healers today. Now, they're very tactful the way they do it, because they don't want to offend you, but they will come out, and you'll pick it out when you're around them. Notice here in verse 1, and Jesus passed by and saw a man which had been blind from birth. Now, here's what the disciples said, and here's what your faith healers claim today. Well, some sin caused this. Lack of faith caused this. Now, he did something wrong. Now, it is true that there are sins that we can do that will bring sickness. That is true. But here we find out this man didn't sin at all, and it wasn't any purpose. Said, and his disciples asked him, saying, Master, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? And it was one of the most asinine, stupid questions that the disciples ever asked Christ. And the reason was, if he was born blind, why would you ask if the man did some sin in order to bring this blindness on him when he was born blind? He wasn't even the age of accountability. It was one of the most asinine, stupid questions that the disciples ever asked Christ concerning the blind man. And they said, who did sin, this man's parents or himself? How could he sin when he was born blind? What could he do before he was born to sin and then be born blind? You see how silly the question was. And this is really how some of the statements of those who claim divine healing today, some of the absolute ridiculous things they propose that are contrary to the Scripture. But then we go on over here and we find out this. They questioned him I would say five times in this chapter. Who was this man? They're always trying to make Christ not God. And the man, they called Christ a sinner, so on and so forth. Notice in verse 35, then the man got saved after all of this happened. So it did not depend upon his faith. Notice in verse 35, and Jesus heard that they had cast the man out, the blind man whom he had healed, and when he had found him, he said unto him, Doest thou believe on the Son of God? And he answered, and he said, Well, who is he, Lord, that I might believe on him? And Jesus said unto him, Thou hast both seen him, and it is he that talketh with thee. At that point, now notice here in verse 38, and he said, Lord, I believe, and he worshipped him. But he was not saved prior to that. Christ healed him. He didn't know who it was that healed him, or anything. But Christ did that. Now, it was God's will that he did that particular thing. Now, another thing we would like to point out, too, that God never took away. Now, we find out here in 2 Samuel chapter 12. And if you have your Bibles, let's go back here. I'm sure most of you recall the record of David. David had seen Bathsheba. He had, instead of being out on the front lines, was where he shouldn't have been. Bathsheba was out doing what she shouldn't have been doing. And he laid lies upon her. One thing led to another. He had a scheme that he called Bathsheba's husband in, sent him out to the front lines, had him killed, first-degree murder, then committed adultery with his wife. Well, due to that, we find out that because of that murder, sin, which was the adultery, sin, which was murder, that God said, and he levied a couple of things because of that. Now notice, if you will, in verse 10 of 2 Samuel chapter 12, God said, "Now therefore the sword shall never depart from thine house, because thou hast despised me and hast taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be thy wife." So the first thing was, you find out that the sword will never depart from his house. I'm sure that you recall that his son Absalom tried to steal the kingdom from him and so forth, ended up dying, riding a horse, catching his head between a fork in a tree and died. But then we find out another thing that God levied against that. He said in verse 11, "Thus saith the Lord, because, behold, I will raise up evil out of thine own house, and I will take thy wives before thine eyes and give them unto thy neighbors, and he shall lie with thy wives in the sight of this son. And for thou dost it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel and before the sun." So that was the second thing. The next thing he said here in verse 14, "Because of this great deed that you've done, thou hast given great occasion for the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme. The child also that is born unto thee shall surely die." And here David had committed a sin unto death in this particular manner. As we are told in 1 John chapter 5 and verse 16, "There is a sin unto death, and I do not say that you pray for it." Why? Because God is not going to reverse his decision on what he decides to do concerning that. Only the sin unto death in this particular case did not involve the death of David, but rather involved the death of his son that was to be born. So there are sins, as we're speaking of here, clear back here in the book of James here. If any of you that have committed sins, and let him confess them, and that's what he says back here. No doubt this person back here committed them, and then we find out that it brought the chastening hand of the Lord. Now, I'd like for you to hold your place here and go with me now over to, if you will, and let's examine the Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Now, we hold the place here and go over here to 2 Corinthians chapter 12. And we find out here that Paul had an infirmity, and we're going to find out that God said, "No, I'm not going to take it away, Paul. You're going to have to live with it, but I will give you grace to live with it." Now, let's notice here, if you will. He said over here, 2 Corinthians chapter 12, he said, and let's begin here with verse 6, "For though I would desire to glory, I should not be a fool, for I will say the truth, and now I forbear, lest any man should think me above that which that he seeth me to be, or that he heareth of me, and lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations. There was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure." Now you see, Satan likes to afflict us with sin if he can. He did this with Job. A lot of times we do not know what's going on behind the scenes in the conversation between Job and God. And here we find out a messenger of Satan actually inflicted this, whatever it was, upon the Apostle Paul. But it was by the permission of God. You see, Satan cannot afflict anyone with sickness unless he gets permission from headquarters. But then the interesting thing about this is, Paul could not heal himself. And yet Paul had performed many, many miracles. We find out that he could even take his handkerchief and lay it on someone and cause a healing. God gave him that power. We find out in the 28th chapter of the book of Acts, he performed a healing again. But then after that, we find out where Paul could not do it anymore. That power was taken away from him. Now notice in verse 8, "For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me," now here we go, Paul knew when the Lord had spoken to him that it was not God's will that God take away this affliction that Paul had. But he asked the Lord three different times for it, and the Lord told him, he said, "My grace is sufficient for thee, and my strength is made perfect in weakness. And most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, and in necessities, and in persecutions, and in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong." You know something I remember in Bible college? We had a tremendous Bible teacher. This Bible teacher that we had taught various subjects. He was an excellent teacher on spiritual life. He was an excellent teacher. He was a very intellectual man and a very smart, just filled full of wisdom of the Scriptures. He knew the cults inside and out and was just a whiz on being able to answer the Mormons, Jehovah's Witnesses, and Unity and various things like that. Knew all these cults from beginning to end. Very, very wise. Excellent in counseling. But this great Bible teacher at that time was born with a cleft palate. They had to do many, many operations on him, and he had one of the lips up here that had just really scarred up. It became very hard for him to even talk. He had nothing in the upper roof of his mouth. All that had to be taken off of other parts of his body and sewed in and put up there. There was nothing there. He was born with nothing on the top of his mouth at all. Nothing. Just one of those freak things, I guess. But anyway, he, just when you would look at him, he did not really look very good. But as he began to preach and as he began to teach, you never even noticed anything about that cleft palate and all the operations he had and the hair lip that he had and so on and so forth. And it was really obvious, but you admired him so much because he loved the Lord and had the love of God in him so much that you never even paid it. Just so overshadowed with the glory of God in the man that it overshadowed the physical handicap that he had. And we never even, after a while, hardly even paid any attention to it because we admired him so much because of the great Bible teaching that he gave us in Bible college. He had quite an infirmity, and I remember one time he was telling about how many, many operations that he had. Never thought that he could. It was very hard for him to even eat. They had to put a tube down him and so on and so forth, and very, very hard. And he lived with that infirmity. And I remember him giving a testimony one time, and he said, "Oh, I just pray to God that I could be normal like other boys and girls and could look nice like they look and would have a nice facial appearance and so forth." And really, if you just looked at him as a man, you didn't know him and didn't admire him or anything else, he did really look bad. He really did. And he said as a young boy, he often asked God that why did he have to be plagued with such a misfortune as to have this kind of ailment. But then when he went on, God blessed him and he became really one of the great, great Bible teachers. He blessed thousands upon thousands of students that were in Bible college, encouraged them to go on to serve the Lord. And looking at his example, we thought, if this man can overcome this kind of handicap by the grace of God, in other words, God gave him the grace, and he said, "My grace is sufficient for thee, and my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, would I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me." You know something? Christ used that man with all of the infirmities that he had and the many, many operations that he had to encourage so many other Bible college students, thinking, if this man can overcome these obstacles by the power of Christ, then I do not have an excuse why I cannot go on and be a better servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. But it took that infirmity and it took that hair lip and that cleft palate and the many, many operations that he had and his testimony, which turned out to be a tremendous, tremendous encouragement to thousands upon thousands of Bible college students that encouraged them to go on to the Lord, because if they could see the greatness and the way God used this man in a great and mighty way with all the infirmities that he had, then you and I have no excuse. With the facial features that we have and the things the way God's blessed us, we have no excuse for not going on and serving the Lord and being used of Christ. When we see a man like this with his infirmities. Now, whatever it was, we find that Christ said, "No, Paul, I'm not going to heal you. I'm not going to heal you at all." Now, in a few minutes we have left, I would also like to point out something, if I may. You find out as you go on here that there are some other men, too, that these healings in the New Testament were taken away, the power to do it. If you'll notice, you may want to write these down. We do not have time to look at them now, but at least we'll give you who they are and the scriptures here in our remaining time. There was a man by the name of Epaphroditus in Philippians chapter 2, verse 25 to 30. We find out that Paul could not heal him. There was also Timothy. in Timothy, 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 2, and chapter 5, verse 23, and that was about in 62 A.D. And we find out that Paul said, Timothy, you take a little wine for your stomach's sake. And he didn't say take wine and get drunk, and he didn't say take wine because you're addicted to the habit. But wine back then, I remember my father, was prescribed by a doctor, said you take a little cup of wine before a meal, and it was used as an appetizer. And Dad did it, I remember that. Trophimus, in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 20, was another one Paul couldn't heal. And, of course, himself in 2 Corinthians here, chapter 12, verse 7 to 9. In conclusion this morning, then we're going to bring in next week where the miracles concerning the healings of Isaiah chapter 53, verses 4 and 5, were really fulfilled in the New Testament by the Lord Jesus Christ and the apostles. Yet, that door's still been left open to deceive people. And I might say this, if I may. Many misinformed people have been led to believe that it is God's will to heal everyone. This is not so. So-called faith healers almost always blame the failure on your lack of faith. The result is that the person who is sick is disillusioned, thinking, first of all, that God's let them down, and second, that this proves there is no God, for if there was a God, he would have healed them. Number three, they're thinking themselves a failure for their lack of faith, and of course, the truth is, God never promised to heal everyone, only those whom that it is his will to do so. Now, if we examine God's word, we'll not be disillusioned by those who are making false promises for God that he never made himself. And I'll say this again. You challenge the faith healers to go to the hospitals with you and heal the people in the hospitals as they claim to heal in church. And you're going to put them to the acid test of whether it is true or not. And when they say it's God's will that everyone be healed, they are liars and not telling the truth. You may have an infirmity. It may be God's will that you carry it until you die. But one of the great promises we do have is when we put off this body, get our new glorified body in heaven, we'll never have an ailment again. It'll be a perfect body, fashioned like unto his glorious body, whereby he's able even to subdue all things unto himself. So in glory and in heaven, I'll have a brand new spiritual body that will never see sickness, sorrow, or death again. But while I have this human body, it may or may not be God's will that I be sick. But no matter what condition I'm in, I will glorify in my infirmities, praising God and claiming his promise that my grace is sufficient in order to endure whatever I have to go through. Now, in closing, again we say the greatest healing you can ever have is the forgiveness of sins, so that you'll never have to spend eternity in the lake of fire and pay for your own sin, your own debt of sin, which is death. God said, I love the world, gave my only begotten Son, and whosoever believeth in me will never perish but have everlasting life. Spiritual healing is everlasting. Physical healing is only temporary. Physical healing and physical sickness is temporary, but if you'll trust Jesus Christ, your eternal life is for eternity. So spiritual healing is much greater than physical healing, and we hope you'll put your trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, and you'll never perish, but have everlasting life. If you're listening today, and you do not know that you have eternal life, you're not absolutely sure that you're going to heaven when you die, then here's how simple that it is. God has concluded we all have sinned, that you and I. God has also said that he loves the sinner. And we find out in Romans 5:8, God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And then in John 3:16, God loved the world. He loves you. He gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him would never perish, but have everlasting life. If you realize you're a sinner and Christ is a wonderful Savior, and he died on that cross to save you from spending eternity in hell, so you could have a home in heaven with him. He bought your right to live with him for all time and eternity. All he asks you to do is believe the record God gave of his Son, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Well, I want to thank you for joining with us. Our time slipped away. I'd like for you to join us in our World Wide Web, www.heritagebbc.com. And also, if you've never written us, you'll do that. It is Heritage Radio Bible Class, Post Office Box 573, Walnut Grove, Minnesota, and our zip code is 56180. Until next week at the same time, may the Lord richly bless you as we ever pray. Even so, come, Lord Jesus.